is our honoree for this symposium, Dr. Robert Eichens, who's going to talk to us about early days of infrared of adsorbed molecules. Bob.
First, I want to thank Bert and George for organizing the symposium. I'd also like to thank Keith Hall for the photogenic presentation that he made yesterday. Keith had phoned me. He was worried that he would be showing the same slide that I might want to show, but I told him that he could show any slide he wanted. And if I showed the same slide, I would just give it a less glamorous insider view of what's actually going on. Now, much of the credit of our work belongs to the atmosphere of our group that was due to Elsie Race, the lady Elsie Race, who was the supervisor. He was an electronics expert. He didn't have no background in catalysis whatsoever. When I was hired, there was no interview trip. I was just hired on the basis of the brief interview at school. And Texaco had told Race to add fundamentals of catalysis to his group. But when I got there, after a few weeks, he called me in and said, asked me what I wanted to work on. Well, in those days, the fad in catalysis was a topic called heterogeneous or induced heterogeneity, whether the catalyst was uniform or whether it was at different energy of absorption sites. And the problem came from the fact that the heat of absorption would fall as you fill the surface, but it wasn't clear whether that was due to something inherent in the metal surface or whether the gas that was absorbed was modifying the surface. Well, I explained this background to him and said I thought we could get information on it by exchange work, where you start off with a surface that was completely covered with the radioactive material and then exchange it with a non-radioactive. And since your surface would always be in the same state, any differences would be evidence of the heterogeneity. And I proposed to work with CO and iron because Texaco was interested in that system. They actually built a Fischer-Tropsch plant, Texaco did. It was an economic disaster. Now, I'm sure that many of you cannot understand how they could bring in a brand new person and ask him what he wanted to do. The managers in the group would just turn pale at this thought. The fact was that I was the first catalysis man there, so I was sort of the expert in my work. I was allowed to go on this work. No proposal, no written proposal, no anonymous reviewers, none of these complications that people have these days. And when I started, there were five in the group besides Race. Infrared was the major interest of the group. There were three people in that. One was working on instrumentation, high sensitivity thermocouples. And the other two were working on trying to analyze hydrocarbon mixtures. This was before gas chromatography, and they were trying to analyze hydrocarbons with infrared, which never really succeeded. Well, then the first lesson is send people to conferences. I went to this Gordon conference, and there was a big discussion about all the experts of whether it was Lewis or Bronson or acidity. And later, after I got home, and the fact that I was in an infrared atmosphere, the thought occurred to me that that if there was a proton involved and you absorbed ammonia, you'd get an And these charts had every frequency and what species were at that frequency. And I looked at the Calthrop chart, and there was a difference between NH3 and NH4. So I went to Mapes, who was running one of the instruments, and asked him if he had run the sample for me. And he agreed. So we started the work, again, without any clearance from anybody, but it wasn't really bootleg work, because this is just the way things were done. That was the way. I'm going to try to run the slides here.
I'll probably have to turn it on. There is just this. We haven't got it on yet. Okay, well, no. On the side of it, yeah. Okay, try pressing that forward button again now. There you go.
Now this was the way I viewed it. This is one of the slide comparable to the one that Keith showed, that if it was a Lewis acid, it would be held as NH3. If it were a Bronsted acid, either due to addition of water or to an inherent proton to balance the aluminum silicon, you'd get NH4. The spectrum was clearly NH3. The miracle is that we still see NH3 as a Lewis acid because we had no infrared cell. And I did this on a little tube, and I had to seal the end windows on in a dry box and so on. And this system is extremely sensitive to any moisture and air at all. Converts it over. Well, then, this was a great encouragement, but Mapes left the company and went to IBM, and IBM was just getting started about 10 miles north of Beacon in Poughkeepsie, and it had tremendous opportunities for people. So he was once going to IBM. It didn't concern him that he was a co-author in this work at all, and he was replaced by Pliskin, who's going to be working with me full-time, and by Stan Francis to sort of supplement Pliskin, because Pliskin was new and he had done a theoretical thesis, so that Pliskin and I together had never ran an infrared spectrometer. Stan Francis still kept his major interest in hydrocarbon analysis, and later he went over to the reflection work on Texaco, or wanted to get lubrication studies of infrared. They were so happy with the catalyst, the iron catalyst work. Then, because of my background with the exchange work, of course I tried iron first, and there's no doubt we had never any trouble. We start with iron oxide, reduce it, absorb CO, no problem whatsoever. But the surface area was very low, so I went to support the iron, and we just never got any results that were reproducible over about 2 months of trying. Sometimes we thought we had something, and then we didn't have anything. And to anticipate Alvin Ice's question, we didn't know whether we absorbed any CO on the sample or not. It was so small that we really couldn't tell, and we didn't have a con balance set up at that time. So I became familiar with some work that Houdard did with CO on platinum and decided to go over to that. Now, one of the way that we operated was that we were technicians that actually ran the instruments, and we would write out the instructions for the technicians. And the first technician A, when he did the thing, there was just a beautiful spectrum of CO on platinum. We would have had champagne, we'd have opened up the bottles and he then went on vacation and reproduces Technician B took over, using the same written instructions that Technician A had. And Technician B, you couldn't even get the beam through the sample. It just and after about three failures, I sent the samples to the electron microscope. And the good sample, it was a very, you see what I have in the circle, it was a nice small platinum particle. In our case, that what I'm talking about now is about 50 angstroms. We had a heavily loaded sample, 9% platinum. The poor sample, the one that didn't work, you can see some of the platinum crystals, they're great big clumps of plastic. And by this time, the technician had returned from his vacation, and after going over both of them with what I had written, it turned out that the difference was that on the place where it says reduce it in hydrogen at 300 degrees, the first technician had brought the sample up to 300 and put the hydrogen through. The second technician started the hydrogen flow at room temperature and then brought it up to 300. And platinum reduces so easily that even at room temperature it reduces. And it was being reduced in solution. And when we followed that up, we sort of forgot about that. Now, Norm Shepherd made a comment about my clear writing. I was at a meeting like this, and before the presentation started, there were two men that were sitting near me, and they were discussing something, and I didn't pay any attention to what they were saying until one of them very emphatically said, "Eichens is a bastard." And then I started to listen, and they had run into the same problem that I just discussed. And when we wrote the thing, we didn't say, be sure that you don't try to reduce it at too low a temperature, and then this man thought that we had deliberately left that out to make it harder for us. This experience occurred to a lot of people. It was poor, sloppy writing. Dick Gonzalez visited us with a graduate student, and he reminded me that I had told him that this is so easy to get C1 platinum that it could be a laboratory experiment in elementary physical chemistry. So the graduate student went back and he ran into the same problem, but didn't get this. But anyway, after this experience, we easily went through these other metals, which you've seen before. Now, what I want to emphasize is how fortunate it was that we were able to interpret these. And one of the great advantages was there was very little literature. In the literature, there was iron carbonyl, which had linear and bridge COs, and it had band above 2,000 and one below 2,000, and there was nickel carbonyl, which had bands only above 2,000. Well, that you don't have to be very smart to see them at above 2,000 is the linear, and the below is bridge. And that's the interpretation and that we used. It would be extremely difficult now to look at the literature and come up with such a simple conclusion, because you can shift these things way around by adding substituents, which went on. But we had the simple interpretation, and I can say that aside from Norm Shepherd, the infrared people didn't have any interest in this work at all. It was just the lowest brow infrareders who do their interpretation by comparison of the bands. That's No, as I said, we were not so far behind the conventional inorganic chemists in this. And the place where we were ahead of them was in the case of nitrogen. There was no evidence that nitrogen molecules bonded to nickel or any other metal in the literature. And we saw bands that seemed to be due to nitrogen on nickel. And the question was, is it a molecule with two nitrogens, or is the thing split apart? And you're seeing a triple bond between the surface and a single thing or not. And I approached this with isotopes, using the idea that if you had nitrogen-214 and nitrogen-215, and the mixed nitrogen-14-15, you'd get three bands if the nitrogen remained together. The molecule, if it split apart, you'd only get nitrogen-14 and nitrogen-15 band. So we tried this on nickel. And you see we got the band of nitrogen-14, nitrogen-15, but we only got two bands when we put them in together, which meant that we were looking at individual nickel atoms, not a nickel molecule. I just couldn't accept this, and I sent the sample to the gas sample for mass spectrometry, and it still had only nitrogen-14 and nitrogen-15. I thought that it would exchange in the way that Keith Hall mentioned for the CO, but it didn't exchange. So then I took the mixture and put it over iron at a high temperature and got it exchanged so that we knew we had them. And you see the three bands, which proved we were looking at a nitrogen molecule. And within a year or so, the inorganic chemists did start making compounds which had molecular nitrogen bonded to metals. Now, I told about the benefit of going to the Gordon Conference was another example of the benefit of going to the meetings was my going to, I had previously gone to a meeting at the Philadelphia Catalyst Club. At the time, that was the only club that was. Even though it was more than a three-hour drive, that's where we went. And heard a man from Johns Hopkins give a talk on a new type of silica, which was made by burning silicon chloride. And the unique thing about this was it was small round balls of silica, and that's what the surface area came from, because these things were so small, and it didn't have pores. And I thought this material would be beneficial with less scattering. So I tried to find someone at Texaco, and I went to the practical catalyst people. They didn't have any. I went to the purchasing agent and asked him who bought silica. And he said, the grease department buys silica. So I went over there, and they had this material called Cavasil that they were using to thicken grease. And I took that back. And it did have the advantage of less scattering, but that was a minor advantage compared to the fact that Cavasil is the least reactive of any support. And you can reduce metals on it much easier than on any other thing. And the next slide, it shows a reduction of nickel under comparable conditions using alumina, a regular silica, and way up on the top there, the black spot, Cavasil. So the Cavasil is even better than regular silica as far as not interacting. And alumina is clearly more reactive with the metal, and you get aluminates formed more easily. Nickel is about in the middle of metals. Platinum's the easiest, and iron is the most difficult. So this Cavasil gave us a tremendous advantage of simplicity at this early stage. Now that the, when we interpreted the work of carbonyls or with nitrogen, we were always looking at the frequencies within the adsorbed molecule. We could not see any bonding from the surface to the adsorbed molecule because of this interference from the support. George Blyholder is credited with being the first group, the first man, whatever you want to call him, to actually see the metal carbon bond in adsorbed CO. And he did this by evaporating very thin films and having the work without any support. Keith Hall mentioned the importance of the CNO work, so I added some, on the basis of that, I added some slides. Because our work with ZNO, zinc oxide, was one of my greatest disappointments. And in fact, there was that one time when Kokas came to visit and he was planning to do infrared work, and I said, stay away from zinc oxide, it's just terrible. And the samples are not reproducible, and the damn stuff changes while you're looking at it. But he went ahead anyway and did this award-winning work. But we started off with a KDOF with the burned zinc. And I had decided I'd make myself a better zinc oxide. And I did this in the process. I made some zinc oxalate using ammonium oxalate. And when we put, on the next slide, when we put oxygen on my zinc oxide, the vacuum line, you see, but if you put in the oxygen, you see these bands, when you look at them, you see they're either carbon-oxygen bands or nitrogen-oxygen bands. And I thought I must have left some of the nitrogen and carbon on the surface, and that's what was reacting with the oxygen that I was adding. However, if you put in oxygen 18, the band didn't shift at all, and the so we tried chlorine. The next slide, and we got the same bands with chlorine. So obviously, what we were seeing had nothing to do with what we were adding to the surface. And as I said, this work led to my biggest disappointment. And the work was done by Dwight Smith, who talked this morning, but was not, he had nothing to do with the disappointing part. What I concluded was that by putting an electronegative gas on the surface, we were causing reactions within the bulk of the zinc oxide, and that these impurity carbons inside of the zinc oxide were reacting with the oxygen in the zinc oxide when you put the electronegative thing on. So it didn't make any difference whether it was oxygen or chlorine or whatsoever. And my disappointment comes from the fact that I thought this was a very interesting observation, but we had not one single request for a reprint request, not one single reference to it that I know about. And I would be even happy now if someone said it was all wrong, just to show that it had some interest in it. Well, the next slide, I wanted to show the instrument we used. Now, we made some changes in the instrument when it started off, and it was mainly to get more distance, because we wanted to keep the end windows cold while the sample was heated inside. So that's why we went from the thing where the source is really down there, where it says lower source, I don't know, and we moved it up to the upper. And that gave us a much longer distance so that we could keep the the sample is hot while in the window, the salt window is cold. And we can heat this up to the melting point of glass, and the heat from the cell or the sample would not interfere, because there was a chopper up there in the upper housing, and this chopper converted the radiation to an alternating current, and unless the radiation was before the chopper, it would not be amplified, so that we didn't worry about the heating, or we couldn't, we weren't bothered. Now the next slide is another one of the instruments, and this is Bill Pliskin, who I had a, can you see that? Very productive relationship with for more than 10 years. He also ended up going to IBM, and we got along very well. If I could convince him of something, or if he could convince me of something, then the outsiders didn't have much chance, because we had really tossed it around before then. Now, ordinarily, the technicians run these instruments, but as you know, when pictures are being taken, they get shoved aside. Pliskin is running a recorder, which Race invented, which makes it possible to run the background, then rerun it with the sample, with the gas absorbed, and subtract out the background. So it does, just like a computer does, except it was a human who was doing part of the work. Now the thing had another advantage, that we could pick out the slit openings. Ordinarily, the slits in an infrared spectrometer open up to take care of the energy loss. But that didn't work very well. It worked all right for gases, but it didn't work when you're going to have a solid. Because of scattering, and so that we could run a sample, see how it's scattering, then pick out the slit program we wanted. And thirdly, this chopper that I mentioned that made it possible to have the spectrum on a chart. Now, a year before I came to Texaco, they were still getting infrared spectra on photographic films. And you can imagine the complication that would ensue if you had to go into a dark room to develop your film this time. So these improvements were due to Race, and they were not done with any catalysis work in mind, but they just couldn't have been better suited for our use of the catalysis. Now, the facilities at Texaco were great. There was no publication pressure at all. We could choose what we wanted to do. Never once was I ever told, do this or do that. And you needed to be pretty far advanced in the subject before the Race would even know about it. We had some little pressure from the lawyers, who couldn't understand why anyone would want to spend money on something and then let everybody know about it. The lawyer is a no-win situation for him, because if he lets something by that no harm, he doesn't even get an acknowledgement. If he lets something by and it interferes with the patent, he can keep trouble. And a third advantage of tech was the glass blown support, the machine shop support, and the technicians. And I don't want to compare technicians with graduate students, since there may be some graduate students in the audience. But they really were a tremendous value to us. If they were the ones who worked all day running the instrument. Now, one of the questions that was asked, what did Texaco get out of this? And we never invented any new catalyst. We were at hand for some troubleshooting, and as I was trying to think of what did we do for Texaco in preparing for this talk, I remember one time that they were having trouble with a catalyst involving acetic acid on this catalyst, and we had previously found that acetic acid would absorb in different ways whether the catalyst was wet or dry. And I thought maybe the dry method is the best intermediate. Well, this was an engineer, and they said they dried their feed, and I said, not good enough. And they dried it better, and the process worked. But then they decided later on economic grounds they didn't want this process anyway. So that was not too much. There was another case where they were making aromatics with a platinum dehydrogenation catalyst, and it was running down. And that we had had this experience because they had inadvertently got some alcohol in their feed. And when you get alcohol over platinum, it decomposes to absorb CO. So when they asked me about it, I said, don't worry, just keep running it, and the CO will come off, and in a day or two, it'll be back to normal. And that was right. So that's where our infrared experience helped. And that troubleshooting. In another case, Texaco had a major plant devoted to ethylene oxide, and the catalyst in this system kept going down and down and down. There were, when you buy a commercial catalyst, you sign it, we're not going to analyze. But finally, the trouble became so seriously that Tesla said, you've got to give us permission to analyze what's going on in this catalyst or to a new catalyst company, and they agreed. And we tried various things, and I even sent it out to some of these newfangled surface science things, and they didn't show us anything. The infrared and other absorption didn't show us anything. And these are very low area catalysts. And finally, I sent it out about a year later to another surface science lab, and it came back that there was some phosphorus on this catalyst. And it turned out it came from the man who cleaned the reactor. There's a contractor who cleaned reactors, and he used some sort of phosphoric acid, and he had changed his procedure by a way that no one as a chemist would think would make any difference. But he apparently left this on the walls, and it would gradually come on the catalyst. Now, ironically, Shell was Texaco's major competitor, and they were having the same trouble. And of course, we never discussed our work with Shell. But if we had talked together, we both would have seen that what we had in common was this contractor who was cleaning the reactor. That shows the value of the secrecy. Well, it's not a very impressive record to put up on what good we did for Texaco, but it's the best I could come up with. Thank you.
I think we've learned the benefit of being called a bastard. From then on, your writing was crucified.
Well, what I want to know is after you found out that the man who cleaned the tanks, that he had to change the way he did them for you at Texaco, did you tell him not to change his ways?
Texaco actually sued him, but the trouble was, this little man and his little contracting business, he just didn't have enough money. The damage that had been done.
Well, if nobody else has anything, of course, Bob is still going to be around for a while. Let me remind you then that our session begins.